Good luck.
Good evening and welcome everyone to Columba's second annual Arts Soiree. My name is Rita.
And I'm Charlotte, and we are both so excited to see all your lovely faces here tonight and would like to extend our welcome to those watching at home via our live stream.
We hope you all enjoy the evening, and despite the notable deficiency of food, three-dimensional people, performers and visible chins, we can assure you that it will be just as good, nay, better, than last year. Instead of launching right into it, we decided that it would be prudent to get everyone up to date on the events of 2021 in the least confusing way, which is obviously a comprehensive and detailed extended metaphor. To paraphrase, we've spent 2021 on a boat.
At the start of this year, this boat was something akin to a cruise ship. New Zealand was peacefully floating in the ocean. The arts were to be celebrated, with Columba participating in the Dunedin Secondary School's art exhibition, and with 20 students travelling up to Wellington to compete in the Sheila Wynne Shakespeare competition with a student-directed piece, for which they won an award for outstanding imagination and commitment to the text. Everybody was enjoying life. Takeaways were being had, parties being thrown, arts being celebrated, with shows such as Les Miserables being able to be enjoyed by thousands of people in the Regent Theatre after being postponed last year due to COVID.
But then August rolled round, and with it, the iceberg, known as COVID, popped up again like an overly ambitious door salesman. With our team of 5 million aboard the proverbial sinking ship that was the RNZ economy, we all agreed that to stay afloat, it was necessary to throw some things overboard. Freedom, takeaways, hugs, and the most tragic of them all, our chapel of the arts. So to summarise for the confused viewer, don't talk to strangers and learn how to swim. Before we move on, it would be remiss of us not to spare a moment of silence to grieve the abandoned events of 2021, swept under the rug and forgotten to prevent further emotional trauma and that extended beyond their cancellation. These were Band Quest, the Wind Symphonia Concerts, Celebrate Design Competition, the Big Sin Cadenza Competition, Secondary School's Music Festival, and High School Musical. Fortunately, the powers that be in charge of soul crushing took a brief holiday to allow us to whip up a new cake and shove it in Charlotte's face. In other words, the musical was back on and more determined than ever. Spirits were high, and things were looking up.
Shops opened up, with people being able to munch on some sweet, sweet level 3 takeaways. People waited in line 45 minutes just for a McDonald's Happy Meal. And slowly but surely, we began to regain our freedom, coming back to school and being able to see all of our mates again. The waters calmed, and we were able to settle into a relatively normal way of living, with the only exception being a mask mandate in the Meridian Mall.
The Celebrate Design Competition was reinstated and, as of 5 minutes ago, finished in what I hope was a successful fashion. And although Cadenza has remained cancelled, we were sent this plaque as a consolation prize for being somewhere in the top 17 choirs in the South Island, literally celebrating the unsung heroes of Columba's Senior Madrigal Choir. So well done, Cantus Columba. Best of all, that brings us to this evening and the fortunate rescheduling of this celebration of the arts. So without further ado, let us welcome our first performer to the stage.
Our first performer for the evening is Eloise Cameron, who is doing a speech in Te Reo Māori. Eloise has been learning Te Reo since she was 5 years old and was the first student to take Te Reo Māori at NCA Level 1 at Columba. Eloise is very interested in the tikanga and the tahuhu korero, culture and history of Māori. She's an inspiration to all aspiring learners of Te Reo, and her speech is about her love of performing. Please join me in giving her a warm welcome.
Kia ora, ko Eloise tōku ingoa. Ko tōku kaupapa kōrero mō te rangi nei e pā ana ki tētahi runaruna e pai ana ki a au. E kanikani ana au mai i te wā e toru noa iho ōpitau. Koera tekau mā toru ngā tau e kanikani ana au ki tēnei wā tonu. He tino pārekareka ki a au te orihiteki, te tautito, me ngā kanikani o nāianei. Ko Robin Sinclair tōku kā ko kanikani. Ahakoa he pākaha ia, he kā ko pai ia. He pai ki a au ki te whakātu, ki te whakāri hoki i ngā hātepe kanikani. Kia angitu ai i te kanikani, me kaha, pingore hoki, a me whai i ngā tikanga tika o te kanikani. Mā te kanikani e āwhina tōku whakarikarika. I pāhi au me ngā whakamātautau orihiteki me te tautito ki te tōhukai rangi. Nā te nuinga ōku whāranga i ōku waiwai me tōku tuarā kua kōpere o ngā kanikani kua mahia e au i ēnei tau kua hipa. Kei te pīrangi au ki te kanikani tonu mō te roa e taia ana e au. Engari, te rāpea nā te nuinga o ōku whāranga ka kore e taia e au, te tū hei kaikanikani ngaio i ngā rangi e heke mai nei. Tēnā rāwa atu koutou mō te whakarongo in English. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you, Eloise. Next up, our fearless leader, who will be performing next, began singing in the junior choir here at Columba. I dare say it's been uphill ever since, winning awards in both the Green Island and Dunedin singing competitions for many years. She progressed to the New Zealand Secondary Students Choir 3 years ago, where she has also won, through auditions, the chance to do solos. I present our extremely gifted vocalist, Rosie Ockerville.
Thank you.
The midst of lockdown was a good time, as good a time as any, to initiate this year's photography competition. And after weeks of careful deliberation, we are proud to announce the winners of this very prestigious competition.
First off, we'll start with our special mentions. A big congratulations to Nora Paiku, Aidan Forbes, Angela Fu, Emily Prout, Heidi Palmer, Rosie Davison, Raheela Yezkeely, Kieran Basil, Zoe Trotman, and Sean Robertson.
For our staff section, first place goes to the fabulous Mr. Andrew Moore with a gorgeous picture of the sheep and their lamb. For the years 5 and 6 section of the competition, first place goes to Mia North in absentia with a stunning photo of a rose.
For the years 7 to 8 section, the runner-up is Ella Reid Blair in absentia with this great flower photo. And our winner is Sean Robertson with this adorable photo of a dog. Sean also won the Best Collection Award across all sections of the competition, showing a fantastic eye for detail. Congratulations, Sean.
Section, our runner-up for this year is Kate Baskerville in absentia with this photo of a bunny. And our winner for this section is Emily Sharp with a sweet photo of a monkey.
Lastly, the years 11 to 13 section. This section was definitely the hardest to judge, with lots of photography talent being shown by our senior students. After some long deliberation, we came to a conclusion, with our runner-up being Zoe Riffle Lynch, with this beautifully detailed photo of an insect's wings, and our senior winner for the 2021 photography competition being Emily Prout in absentia, with her breathtaking mountain photo. Congratulations to all who participated this year. There was some fierce competition and you should all be very proud of yourselves. Our next performer for the evening is a talented oralist who won this year's Year 13 speech competition. She was inspired by the media discussing societal expectations on women's body standards and chose to write a highly captivating speech about how the beauty industry manipulates us. Please welcome Lily Frewin.
Imagine you were born into a world in which nobody ever commented on other people's features. You didn't grow up staring at magazines and waiting in line at the supermarket. You didn't watch reality TV on Bravo. Your mum never went on a fad diet. The thing is, no one is born wanting a different face or body. The baby version of you had no preconceived, absorbed notion about the way you should look. We can all see and accept that beauty standards are bad for us as women. Yet many of us struggle to come to terms with the fact that forcefully changing ourselves to adhere to these standards may also be a bad thing. Beauty standards don't just exist out of nowhere. So much of what we consume today with modern media is purposefully manufactured to create and reiterate impossible standards. The beauty industry is hard at work every day, conjuring up a new rage. Constant trends surround body types and facial features. 10 years ago, telling someone that they had a big butt was an insult, and now there is an epidemic of BBL surgeries to achieve that infamous hourglass shape. Thick or thin, foundation covered or barefaced, it doesn't matter. No one can reach every expectation at once. This evil cycle leaves women constantly searching for an unattainable perfection. The revolving door of beauty standards is designed to leave us both jaded and anguished. The idea of perfection is endlessly dangled in front of us, yet we are never allowed true acceptance. And there you have it. It's the beauty industry's perfectly constructed, endless loop of consumption and self-defeat. And we are told to accept this. The media constantly tells us that the route to self-love and satisfaction is to spend money on fixing ourselves. We are being taught that it is empowering to go under the knife for a bigger butt or a smaller nose, and that we will come out of it knowing that we are the best version of ourselves. While that seems true on the surface, what is really happening is that women and girls are being coerced into conforming to the idea created by men of what we should look like. And when that young girl gets a rhinoplasty or a boob job, she might say, "It did it for me." The hard truth is that she did it for the flawless lady on the magazine, for her peers who expected it, but most of all, for the companies for whom it financially benefited, the big men and higher-ups who have groomed her from adolescence into this need. So, should we really accept every scrap of so-called empowerment that is tossed our way without thinking critically about it? I think we need to start asking who is really in control of the modern feminism narrative and whose purpose is it serving. The fight for women's rights is mixed up with a lot of nonsense empowerment that has everything to do with selling products and nothing to do with how we feel inside. Ad campaigns simply state, "All women are beautiful and all women are sexy," as if those declarations somehow grant us real rights. The idea of a woman's appearance being the source of her worth enables advertisers who market vanity products to continue selling things as surrogates for real women's empowerment. Stephanie Holland reported that 85% of all brand purchases are made by women, while only 3% of advertising executives are women. The myopic focus on making feminism all about dealing with physical insecurities serves as a distraction from the real fight for education, justice, wage parity, reproductive health care, among other matters which pose the biggest tangible consequences for women and girls. Massive companies that sell beauty products perpetuate harmful beauty standards at the same time that they use foam empowerment to sell those products, keeping us looking to the same sources that created the basis for that scrutiny to be the ones to cure us of the damage. McAndrews and Forbes, the parent company of Revlon Cosmetics, which despite its breast cancer awareness initiatives and various women's philanthropy, was founded by men, continues to be run by men, and gives the majority of its campaign contributions to extreme conservative anti-choice candidates. This all contributes to a larger system of oppression where beauty standards are being repackaged as empowering and our real rights are being stolen. This is a manipulation of the customer, not an empowerment for women. Our actions don't exist in a vacuum, but it's better to critique and analyze the practice rather than the participating individual. Don't criticize or shame the women who have gotten plastic surgery. Critique and fight the system that made them feel they need it. Adhering to these beauty standards can oftentimes make the weight of simply existing under the system just a little bit lighter. Andrea Dworkin said, "Many women, I think, resist feminism because it is an agony to be fully conscious of the brutal misogyny which permeates culture, society, and all personal relationships." I'm standing before you today as a girl who gets eyelash extensions, wears makeup, and has a layer of Bondi Sands tan covering my body. Things like these make me feel prettier, fancier, more put together. So, I am a hypocrite, and I'll never claim that it is easy to rise above the notions of beauty given to us by our society. However, we can reclaim the feminist narrative when we can admit to ourselves and others that these standards are harmful to us. Once we do this, we are on track to a more open and honest discussion that has the power to truly liberate us. Too much focus on appearance is what hurts so many of us in the first place, so a focus on what your body can do for you could act as a solution. Terms like perfect and beautiful are loaded and filled with connotations of rank and judgment. Body neutrality as a concept is a powerful tool that can allow us to exist without placing labels on ourselves or quantifying our worth. Unlike the body positivity movement that is plagued with bias, body neutrality encourages you to see your body as a functional vessel. It does not need to involve self-love talk or mantras. A genuine acceptance of your existence and a gratitude for your body's function is a refreshing idea. With that in mind, I hope we can all be aware of the dangerous rhetoric of compulsory beauty and that we can find the courage to question it and to stand up to the male conglomerate who only seek to empower themselves. Thank you.
We're now about to present the trophies, cups and prizes for arts for the year. So if Mrs. Duffy would like to come up and present, Ms. Baczynskas will assist her. First of all, can we have Skylar Murray, please? Skylar is receiving the Beethoven bust for composition and the Preen cup for musicianship. And could we have Rita Close, please? This evening, Rita receives the Kim Sutton Cup for service to the Madrigal Choir, the prize for service to the school orchestra, and the prize for service to the Wind Symphonia. Angela Fu. Angela is receiving the Ethelwyn McGeorge Prize for Talent and Enthusiasm at the Piano. Sienna Baker. Sienna is awarded the Joan Campbell Memorial Prize for Use of Musical Talents for the School. Penelope Hare. Penelope receives the Steel Shield for consistent contribution to school drama. Millie George. Millie is awarded the Sarah and Anna Somerville Trophy for Excellence in the Performing Arts and the Prize for Excellence in Senior Drama. Grace Johnston. Grace receives the Brenda Saville Memorial Prize for Drama and is a co-recipient with Charlotte Werner of the Denise Henderson Cup for Musical Theatre Excellence. Can we have Skylar Murray? Also receives the cup for the Year 11 Speech Competition winner. And Grace Johnston, back again. Grace has won the Year 12 Speech Competition for 2021. And Marie Curran. Lily has just shared with us her winning speech for the Year 13 speech competition this year. Jodie Syme. Jodie is awarded the Bolwell Tray for debating. Sophie Beaumont. Sophie he receives the Natalie Ellis Wilson Cup for Excellence in Debating. And Olivia Charles, please. Olivia is awarded the Anne Crawford Cup for Excellence in Creative Writing and the Shakespeare Bust for Excellence in Essay Writing.
Our next performer is Imogen Harrison, an extremely talented tap dancer who has danced at Denise Henderson's studio for 9 years. Under Denise's tutelage, Imogen has won awards such as the 2020 NZAMD nomination for high tap exam results, won the Tide Intermediate Champion of Champions Award in 2021, and played Jackie Scott in Columba's High School Musical this year. Tonight, she is performing a song and dance number called Music and the Mirror from the musical A Chorus Line. Please welcome Imogen Harrison.
Thank you.
for the evening is a seasoned singer, having competed in singing competitions since she was 8 years old. Although her time on stage has been limited in the world of musical theatre, she has consistently proved her theatre chops, playing the beleaguered geek in Heathers in April this year, and playing Taylor McKessie in Columba College's very own high school musical. This is Millie George performing Fly, Fly Away from the musical Catch Me If You Can.
Child, my eyes were clear. I saw
edition of an arts and literature journal by Columbus students with the title Song of Wings was an idea initially proposed in Term 1 by Mrs. Harris. It would be the first professionally printed anthology of student works at Columbus and the only literature and arts journal in New Zealand written by students at a secondary school. Excited at the prospect, we launched ourselves into advertising, and it only took a little persuasion to coax a multitude of talented authors and artists out of hiding. With submissions rolling in, all there was left to do was some light fundraising. Thanks to the brainchild of a few Year 10 students, the readathon was initiated. Because what better way to raise money for a book than by reading some? Over 60 students relinquished their Saturday to be sponsored for reading. The longer a student would stay in the comfort of the library, eating food, drinking hot chocolate, and cozying up with a good book or few, the more they would earn, whether it was 10 cents per hour or $5. A special congratulation for those that stayed the entire 12 hours. Well done. In essence, this journal has been made possible through the passion and commitment of students and staff, start to finish. I can't express how satisfying it is to be finally holding this book. But don't just take our word for it. You too can hold this book. Well, not this one specifically. But Song of Wings is officially available to purchase.
If you would like to buy a copy of the journal for yourself, we'd recommend it. Don't miss out. Just take a wee stroll over to the office and our lovely office ladies will sort you all out. And only for $18. What a steal! I think that I can speak for both of us in saying that when asked to choose our favourite pieces from the compilation, we both struggled immensely. But in the midst of all the editing, one piece that really resonated with both of us was Glass by Samantha Mills. Unfortunately, we could only print a fraction of this in our journal, but we'd just like to say thank you for sharing this with us, because it was a privilege to read, and it left us both in tears after reading it. From the sweet and the light-hearted to some of the more complex compositions mirroring classic teenage angst, Song of Wings is a fantastic snapshot and a celebration of literature within our school community. We have a limited first run of only 100 copies, so don't miss out.
Lastly, we just have a few special thanks to give. From the support of our teachers and staff to the talented authors we have managed to pull out of hiding. We most definitely could not have done it without you. A special thanks to Mrs. Harris for your devotion to this project. I think we both have a newfound appreciation for editors and English teachers alike, because proofreading is a lot of work. Not to mention the process you had to go through in publishing this journal. Thank you for giving us and the other students involved the chance to be a part of this wonderful project and for the opportunity for all our voices to be heard. Grace Johnston has been writing poetry since she was able to pick up a pen and was first published as a poet in Year 8 in a small section of the ODT. Through her poetry, Grace aims to take mundane concepts and find beauty in them. Tonight she is performing Tangerine Skies, a poem about unhealthy relationships, and unpicks the complexity of surface-level displays of love. Please give her a warm welcome.
Tangerine Skies. I remember you, but you don't remember me. A husky throat and a furried brow. Tangerine skies turn murky when they forget to smell the sun. An omnipotent being of smoky eyes and groundsels, phone calls dripping in the pungency of hospital hand sanitizer. Throbbing heads don't like the pavement much. Capricious strides wallow in gentility. Thump, thump, thump. The spontaneity and rebellious streaks of light that puddle at your feet and trickle up your spine now seem ironic, compared to the tranquil composure you possess or portray. Fingers intertwine so deeply that even the insignificant tingles of sunlight that most often go unnoticed manage to creep up to our foreheads and giggle at our chests. Small hands, small feet. Nibbled nails trace swirls round cedar-strong phalanges. Ripped film tickets crumple in the pocket of her school jacket. Drowning in familiarity is her strong suit. Variant sides, but invariant eloquence, or wobbly sentences? Stumbling tongues paradoxically decimate silly, silly, silly smiles. Sedumist and lingering, cathartic.
Up next is a talented performer who dances well beyond her years. Mona Morrison has been dancing at Rouser Dance School for 8 years and plays regionally and nationally throughout New Zealand for the past 7 years. She has received honours in all of her dance exams and is trained in hip-hop, jazz, contemporary and musical theatre. Tonight, Monet is performing a dance to Breakin' Dishes by Rihanna. Please welcome Monet. Being 15 years old, she is already a long-time member of the Dunedin Youth Orchestra, not to mention also joining the National Youth Orchestra 3 years ago, as well as placing as a semi-finalist at a national level in chamber groups earlier this year. She has recently been accepted into performance violin at Otago University and will be doing this in conjunction with NCA Level 2 studies next year. As an accomplished violinist, composer, singer, and pianist, she completely embodies all that we stand for in music excellence at Columba. Please welcome Skyla Murray.
young writer with a passion for both history and the sciences. Paired with a proficiency in public speaking and the humanities in general, we know she is bound to do brilliantly in her anthropology studies next year. So, since she is more than capable, we'll let her speak for herself. Miss Olivia Charles.
By circumstance, people, place, and time chip away at us until all that's left is what stares back at us in the mirror every morning. I received a package in the mail the other day. It was a biography that my grandmother had written, her life bound up in paper and words. How can a whole person fit between these pages? Her perspective as she looked back was sweeping, encapsulating all that came before her, and generously garnished with a few golden anecdotes. These stories are what I remember the most from her book, even now, reminding us that we are all some combination of our darkest days and our favourite tales to tell at dinner parties. We are all a combination of people. When we look back, it's those who share our humanity stand tall and bright in the darkness of our memory. The subtle influences of friends, family, even total strangers, imprint on us more deeply than we can possibly know. I maintain the narrative that I was raised by strong women, including all of you. And recently I learned that my grandmother has always maintained that same narrative when she wrote, "Being surrounded by strong women wasn't anything other than normal for me." Narratives are important. We are only the narratives we choose to tell ourselves. So, what if you are unsure of your narrative? I think my favourite quote from my grandmother's book is, "I'm a Jewish grandmother, I can't leave anyone out." Her identity is so firmly rooted in that. She never doubts her status as a Jew, it's a very strong part of her. For most of the family on my father's side, I imagine it's the same. As for myself, I'm less sure. According to a DNA test I took a while back, I'm a whole 50% European Jewish. You see, my father's a Jew, my mother's not a Jew, and that means I'm Jew-ish. That ish part has always held very true to me. Sometimes I'm sort of indifferent, or I even forget that a whole half of me is a Jew. Then other times I feel really strongly whenever I learn about the Holocaust or conflict in Israel. I had a dream the other night that someone was in Constance Hall, standing up and telling everyone about the plight of the Jews throughout history. And I stood up and almost metaphorically took the words right out of their mouth and put them in my own because I felt that only I could tell that story. On the DNA website, it remarks that my connection to this ethnicity region may come from ancestors from this community. And it's more right than it could ever know. The only thing binding me to my ancestry is my ethnicity. My whole life seems to be this dichotomy between everyone who came before me and me, making a personal choice about who I want to be. So, I'm unsure about my people, but what about my place? Or are the two one and the same? Whenever the BBC discusses New Zealand, they always mention that we are an island nation. We never really think of ourselves in that way, do we? Perspective in a narrative is everything. I'm glad my mother brought me to these islands when I was just a little girl. How much larger she made the world, and that is a power indeed. But sometimes I feel deeply rooted to that other place, England, where I was born. I find myself imagining some sort of parallel life where my parents are still together, living in the quaint Norfolk town where I was born. I worry about my A-levels, and we take holidays in Europe, picnic on pebble beaches under bright blue British skies, and visit castles in Cornwall on the weekends. And in even rarer times, I feel drawn instead to that place coloured boldly on my DNA map, Central and Western Europe, where the Ashkenazi Jews called home. Belarus, Lithuania, Latvia, Moldova, Poland, Romania, Ukraine. I've never even heard of some of these countries, but according to my DNA, these are the places that I come from. Going even further back, the Jewish population left its ancestral homelands in the Levant, Middle East, and North Africa, and settled in these European countries. This is a concept known as diaspora, from the Greek word spero, which means to sow, and the preposition di, which means over, as the Jewish people left their ancestral homelands and were metaphorically sprinkled over the lands of Europe. But I've only ever been to Europe a handful of times, Africa once, and the Middle East never, so how can I come from these places? As a society, we place such importance on place. The terrible situation in Afghanistan, where the Taliban continue to take over the country, and everyone seems so desperate just to get out, shines a light on this. A clip played on television the other day, which showed hundreds of Afghans gathered around a gate leading to Kabul Airport, to freedom, flashing their passports in the faces of the guards. People put so much value into the sense of belonging to a nation, to a certain place, and believe that by holding its passport, it would guarantee them protection from the death that they feared was coming for them. As the world closes in and restrictions continue to be placed on borders, knowing where you come from seems to have exponentially increased in importance. For those of us who are unsure, it can be hard. Some of you have lived your entire lives in Dunedin. What there must be like, that certainty. Maybe it's nice, or maybe it's better to be a bit of everything and nothing. A citizen of the world. People and place may be uncertain, but one thing that we can all be sure of is time. Right now is now, before was the past, and whatever comes next is the future. Surely there can be no unknown in this, no uncertainty. Yet, it can still be unbalancing to think about our pasts, our presents, our futures. We are living in a time that is characterized by its very uncertainty. And piled on top of this is the fact that some of us find us on the unknown precipice of our lives, about to leave high school and arrive at whatever comes next. A terrifying thought. I chop and change what I think my future will look like every day, where I will live, who I will know, the kind of person I will be. The singer Lorde joins me on these musings in her recent song Oceanic Feeling. In the future, if I have a daughter, will she have my waist or my widow's peak, my dreamer's disposition or my wicked streak? There can be no counting on the future. Who knows what is yet to come? But can we not stand on the firm and unchangeable ground of the past? I used to think so, but now I'm not so sure. Most of our memories we've fabricated in our heads, seen through the rose-tinted sunglasses of youth. We can get lost, always looking backwards. Time can be terribly tricky like that, a belief Taylor Swift shares when she sings, "Time, curious time, it gave me no compasses, it gave me no signs." It's shockingly easy to trip up, lose your way, go astray, but we are told that if you know who you are, you will always have something to fall back on. Yet supposedly knowing who you are means knowing your people, your place, your time, things I've always struggled with. I've been on a journey of 18 years to make it to this moment, taking it one day at a time, step by step, without knowing any of these things. So perhaps they matter less than people believe. Maybe knowing who you are isn't about all of these external factors, but about the things that are truly only you. Your inspirations, your dreams, your experiences, walking in your own unblemished world. Catherine, a character in my favourite film, The English Patient, articulates this sentiment more eloquently than I could ever hope to, in a letter she pens on her deathbed. We die, rich with lovers and tribes, with fears we have hidden in. We're the real countries, not the boundaries drawn on maps with the names of powerful men. All I've ever wanted is to walk on an earth without maps. Thank you.
Thank you, Olivia. It's worth mentioning, just another plug for Song of Wings, that Olivia Charles is the featured author in this first special limited edition of Song of Wings, and wow, she can really write. So grab a copy, have a look. Well done, Olivia. We'd like now to present the Arts Blues for 2021. These are our school's highest achievement in terms of the arts. A Again, Mrs. Duffy will present and Ms. Pachinskas will assist. First of all, we have Rosie Ockenvall for music. Sophie Boma, debating. Eloise Cameron, dance. Languages and performing arts. Rita Close, design and music. Lily Farrow, music. Aidan Forbes, writing and visual arts. Angela Fu, music. Millie George, performing arts. Sarah Glover, performing arts. Penelope Hare, drama. Imogen Harrison, dance and performing arts. Grace Hill, music and performing arts. Alice Johnston, performing arts. Grace Johnston, performing arts and writing. Helen Lee, music. Shella Luckhurst, in absentia, performing arts. Monet Morrison, music and performing arts. And Skylar Murray, music. Skylar, could you stay there? We're also just going to acknowledge our New Zealand representatives. So Skylar has had this honour before, but we just want to acknowledge again that Skylar represents New Zealand in the NZSSSO. Well done, Skylar. And our last award for this evening, to acknowledge Penelope Hare. Penelope has just been accepted for her outstanding directing talents as a member of the Young Shakespeare Company. She'll be one of 20 young people who have been chosen to represent New Zealand by travelling to the Globe in London. Well done, Penelope.
Closer to the finish of this evening, we would like to thank a few people who have offered invaluable help and assistance, not only in organising this event, but have throughout the year been involved in the arts at Columba. Many thanks to Mrs. Harris, for all your support this year personally and with organising art events, fundraisers and Song of Wings. We couldn't have done all of this without you, and despite being an incredibly busy staff member, you always find the time to help with things that students are passionate about. And you do it with such a degree of enthusiasm and optimism that inspires everyone around you. You should know that your commitment is noted, and we are all incredibly grateful for it. Thank you so much.
Miss B, you are so dedicated to the drama department at Columbo. You are hilarious, and your inspiring attitude consistently brightens each girl's school day. Thank you for putting so much soul and energy into the Sheila Wynn competition and believing in each girl who participated. And also a massive thank you on behalf of everyone involved in High School Musical for putting so much effort into making us look fabulous on stage in our costumes, as well as doing the numerous jobs you got wrangled into whilst the show was on. The countless hours you have contributed to the arts haven't gone unnoticed, and you are one of the unsung heroes of the arts at Columbo College.
Mrs. Casbolt, thank you for the hours of thankless work you did for the musical, as well as the other cultural groups within the school over the course of the year. It may not seem like it at times, but we're all truly grateful for everything that you do. So on behalf of all musical students at Columbo, thank you for your time, effort, and patience. On a personal note, thank you for being an amazing mentor to me this year. I can't tell you how much I appreciate your humour, encouragement, and support.
Miss Andrews and Mrs. Dixon in absentia. A massive thank you to you both is due for being such fantastic teachers to girls of all ages here at Columbo. Both your dedication as art teachers is astounding, and you both inspire many young women at this school. Similarly, a massive thanks is in order to you both for being such kind mentors to a lot of us. Both of you are so caring and have helped us through countless dramas over the years. You two truly are the soul of Columbo, and we cannot thank you enough.
Ms. Courtney Hickmont, Ms. Tessa Duggett-Evans, and Mr. Barry Rutledge, thank you all for doing such an amazing job with the school choirs, orchestra, and wind symphony respectively this year. I know it hasn't been easy for any of you in 2021, especially when you and the students worked so hard, only to have competitions and recitals cancelled time and again. But your commitment in the face of adversity, and in some cases crushing despair, is admirable. I can't speak for others, but despite taking up all of my spare time, the moments spent as part of these groups were some of my favourite at Columbo. So on behalf of myself and the other members in these groups, thank you.
Mighty Mr. Hayden, Mr. Moore in absentia, and Mr. Shaw in absentia. Thank you to you all for your continued support of the arts over the years as the HOD of your respective departments and commitment to the Arts Committee this year. The light and joy you bring to all of your classrooms is thoroughly appreciated by the students of Columbo and, quite frankly, unmatched. And you are all invaluable assets to our Chapel of the Arts at Columbo. Thank you also to Mr. Moore for organising the live stream for family and friends at home tonight. Greatly appreciated.
Mrs. Stubby, thank you for pushing the. Thank you to our principal, Mrs. Stubby, for pushing for arts events to go ahead throughout the year. It meant the world to so many students here that they were finally able to perform in the school musical. We can only hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. We are so grateful that, thanks to you, the place for arts at Columbo is steadily expanding. Thank you for supporting us here this evening.
We'd also like to extend a thank you to all who have attended this evening, the students, for your hard work, and the parents and caregivers for your commitment to helping your children flourish in the arts. Whether it be in person or via live stream, thank you for celebrating the talent Columbo has to offer with us.
now, the cruise may be over, but we sincerely hope that you will keep creating and excelling in the arts, because they, and the students who participate in them, truly are the soul of this school. And to finish, and to round off the evening, we will have our last performer, who has been named in the New York Times as one of the rising stars of 2021. She has been told that her voice resembles that of Ariana Grande and Celine Dion, and was also one of Beyoncé's backup dancers at the humble age of 3. Her room is so full of trophies, she just can't actually get to her bed. And she also played Sharpay in this year's production of High School Musical.
Stop, you're too kind, Rita. It's ridiculous.
Give it up for Charlotte Werner. So tonight, to finish off our evening, which I feel very honoured to do, I will be singing The River by Kat Clyde. Times they are changing and times they are moving, and everything I ever knew will never be the same. I lie awake in the same old way, but there's something in the air and it's calling me in, and I know I'll follow. I don't think about it anymore. As the summer ends, I think of our last goodbye. It's hard to imagine the seasons without you by my side, and I know this winter is going to be especially cold. Like the river today I'm here, tomorrow I'm gone. I saw a group of birds passing by. They were moving like a school of fish in the sky. I hold on to the moment and keep it close to me, 'cause it's times like that that I feel so small and I'm humbled, and I feel one with it all.
Concludes our evening. Except that I would just like to say a really personal thank you to our two arts prefects for 2021. The arts prefect role is not easy. It requires a lot, and it has me turning up at unexpected times asking you to do all sorts of things. And you've both been incredibly patient. You are amazing young women, and you are going to go on to do incredible things in the world. I could not have survived this year without you and your support. So I think they deserve a big round of applause. And at this point, parents and caregivers who are watching at home, you can come and pick up your daughters. Thank you. Thank you very much. Good night, everyone.